I could not help but think as we listened to the words of this song, recalls to mind the story of Elijah. And I remember after the fire fell up on Mount Carmel, that the fire itself did not bring the rain. And even in the midst of the fire, the people still had a need for rain. Interesting thing about rain, I watched my father, preacher turned farmer, in his retirement years, grow a huge garden. And we would dig wells. I had a well that was a deep well. It was like 280 something feet down in the ground. We put a man-made pump down in the ground, connected it to some electricity, and every day I would watch my dad take hoses connected to that pump, a sprinkler on the end, and he would water that garden. You've heard me say this before, but there was just something different about man-assisted water. The garden responded differently to rain than it did to simple water. There comes a time in everybody's life where ordinary water just won't do. There comes a time when we gotta have some rain. There's nothing I can do or man can do to manufacture rain in the clouds. God does that all on his own, in his own time, in his own way. Sometimes he sends it with dark clouds and rumblings of thunder and lightning. Sometimes he sends it on a bright sunny day. But whenever it comes because he sent it. We've been sowing. We've been praying. But now we're crying, Lord, send some rain. Send some rain. Before we get into the message today, the Lord just arranges stuff and sets some stuff up that you never could. I didn't talk to the praise team about the song that they were going to sing this morning. We just got back from spending a week in a little island, on a little island off the coast of Nicaragua, where Jose and Leslie and I, we preached three different meetings during a series. And we followed the story of Elijah during that 1 week there. And in my mind, my analytical mind, I'm saying, man, Lord, just 1 week. How in the world are we going to ever be able to get an evangel? If we called it a revival, if we called it a week of prayer, that would have made more sense to me, Simi. But we called it an evangelistic meeting. Jose was preaching in Spanish. I was preaching at a different place on the island. I was preaching in English, different place. Leslie was preaching in English, but being translated into Mesquito. And last Sabbath, we stood in the ocean and baptized 22 precious souls. As a result of God sending some rain. It was hard to stay connected to read Elder Go. I heard you this morning. Elder Fillmore. Social media. There you are. But we did, and when we left on Thursday, we were just getting reports about what had happened in Wisconsin and what had taken place in Baton Rouge. I was in the airport still in the trip when Friday I read about the shooting in Dallas. I remember after reading about the shootings in Wisconsin and in Baton Rouge, saying to my wife, here we go. You can only do this for so long without there being a response. And within days, we were there in Dallas. And I said again, we can only shoulder this for so long without there being another response. And then there was Baton Rouge again. And as I began to look and to ponder, there had been the bombing in Istanbul. There was more bombings. And everywhere I looked, there seemed to be more and more and more accessibility to information about tragedies happening all over. And yet, listen to me carefully, get what I'm saying to you. And yet in 1 week, 22 souls. When we left, I was leaving, got a text from the island that said, Pastor, the doctor on the island and the judge on the island attended the final meeting. And they came to the pastor and said, the judge on the island told the pastor that she wanted to be in the next baptism. It is easy to get discouraged and depressed, disgruntled, disenchanted, even disengaged. But all the while, behind the veil and the scenes unknown, the Spirit of God is doing what he must in order to make ready a people prepared to meet their God. Family, today we have I'm going to try to make it not as difficult as it could be. We have been walking through this month on a theme talking about sex and sexuality. But today I have decided that we need to take a divergent track from that, for it would seem almost irresponsible, aloof, for us not to take the time today to address from the Word of God the things which so nearly and dearly affect you and me and our people in the world today. And so we're going to take a look in the Word of God, and we're going to address the issue of social justice. It is perhaps, and I fully intended earlier in the week to go a different route, and so I want to be fair to you that, and say I don't know that I feel as fully prepared as I would like to be to address this with you, but again, I feel it would be irresponsible for us not to have this conversation today. And so I'm going to ask that as we turn to God. Now, I also recognize that Any comments, any discussion on this topic will elicit emotions and passions that have a broad range from one end of the spectrum and to the other. You have already made up your mind on where you stand, as have most of us. You may hear some things today that would seem to assault your particular persuasion. Be patient. Hang in there. And let's see what God has to say. Pray with me. Father, if there was ever a time that we needed you, it is now. Hearts and lives and homes have been broken, demolished and destroyed. And yet, Lord, here we are in your house. We came because we needed to hear a word from you. Don't disappoint us today. Speak, allow us to hear. And Lord, we will give your name the honor and the glory. For I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Just yesterday, it's been mentioned already, we heard gritting news out of Munich, Germany. We've heard things out of Istanbul, out of Wisconsin and Baton Rouge, out of Dallas and Orlando, out of New York City and Cleveland and Beirut, Lebanon. We've even heard as recently as this week things out of Miami. There are things that have gone down as close as Boynton Beach. We understand a decision is soon to be released as it regards the circumstances in Boynton Beach. And that will affect many of us because it is so close to home. But the question is this: what do we do? What do we do? All around the world, community leaders are asking that question. What do we do? Because it seems complacent and not just complacent, but often complicit if we just sit by and do nothing. And I would concur, I believe the Bible stands by that. To sit by and do nothing is not just complacent, but it is also complicit. For you and I bear the responsibility not just of what we do, but we bear responsibility of what we don't do. And so make no mistake about it, doing nothing is never the answer. There is always something that must be done. But the question remains, what do we do? What do we do about a world that is in turmoil? We've got terrorism and ISIS and bombings and insurrections and riots and disease and natural disasters and killings and murders and poverty and unemployment, collapsing economies, Brexit, domestic violence, sex slave trafficking still in 2016, civil unrest in Turkey, political corruption, escalating racial tensions and social injustice. The wise man said, however, that there is nothing new under the sun. That there have always been these things. The prophet Isaiah, even in his day, saw a time very similar. Take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Isaiah chapter 59. Isaiah chapter 59. And I want to read in your hearing verses 11 through 15. That's the book of Isaiah in chapter 59. And I will read in your hearing verses 11 through 15. In Isaiah's day, he says, we roar like bears, and we mourn like sore doves. Or we mourn sore like doves. We look for judgment, but there is none. For salvation, but it is far off from us. For our transgressions are multiplied before thee, and our sins testify against us. For our transgressions are with us, and as for our iniquities, we know them. In transgressing and lying against the Lord, and departing away from our God, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving and uttering from the heart words of falsehood. Now watch verse 14. And judgment is turned away backward, and justice standeth afar off, for truth is fallen in the street, and equity cannot hear. There is nothing new under the sun. There is nothing new about a justice system that does not work. I'm going to be as candid and as frank as I can with you today. It amuses me, often baffles me, when I see one group look at a case like a Freddie Gray or a Trayvon Martin and say, give it time, let the justice system work. And then the justice system does its job and does not indict or acquits. And then the response from a group of people is, well, it had due process. The justice system has spoken. But turn around and that same crowd when a Secretary Clinton goes through that same process and the same justice system says, we will not indict. Now you've got a whole swath of the society shouting, chanting, lock her up. Lock her up. Equity has fallen in the streets. Now, I'm not speaking, just to clarify, to the guilt or innocence of either party in either of those scenarios. What am I talking about? Equity. Being fair on both sides of the issue. If you're going to say that there's nothing wrong with the justice system, it did its work on one end, then you've got to be willing to say the justice system worked and did its job on the other end as well. But if there's a problem with the system, then go ahead and say there's a problem with the system and be willing to admit it. But Isaiah says, this isn't new. It's been happening ever since my day. Of all this, we have been warned that not only were these things prevalent in the past, but similar times would return again in the last days just before the second coming of Jesus Christ. Take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3. What book did I say? 2 Timothy, a familiar text, 2 Timothy chapter 3, 2 Timothy chapter 3. And I want to begin reading in verses 1 through 7. And the Bible says this: know this, this know also, that in the what days? Last days, perilous times shall come. For men will be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent. That means they don't have any self-control. Fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a, and by the way, all of these characteristic traits that are being predicted or prognosticated by Paul, he's not talking about people who are living out in the world. Why do we know this? Because the next verse, where he says that these, who are all of these things, they have a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. These truce breakers, these heady, high-minded, incontinent folk, these are church folk. These are folk who are tithe paying, baptized, going to church on Sunday and Saturday, who have a form of godliness. They know how to not just sing, but sing. They know how to shout. They know how to get their praise on. Preachers who know how to get their hoop on, having a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. Well, what's the power that they're denying? The power that they are denying is the power that works on the inside to convert and change a heart, because they're still doing all of the same stuff that everybody else is doing, and they haven't been changed by the power of which they preach. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. And then the Bible says, from such, some of us are going to have to, wow. You know what that means, right? Can we be real for just a second? For some of us, that means that we're going to have to turn away from our own selves. But isn't that the heart of the gospel? To turn away from self. He goes on. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins and led away with different lust, ever learning but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. So what do we do? What do we do? In spite of all of this, when it comes to social issues and social justice, and I'm not just talking about us as black folk or people of color. What I'm really addressing is not that. What I'm addressing is, what do we as a people of God, a people of faith, who say that we are longing for and awaiting the second coming of Jesus Christ, who have been commissioned and released to give to the world the last final warning, the fact that Jesus is coming again, that the judgment has set, that the books have been opened, that right now in glory the final phases of judgment are going on, and that soon the books will be closed, soon he will stand up and say, he that is just, let him be just still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. I'm talking about us. What do we do? Those of us who believe that this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all the world, and then shall the end come. I'm not talking about our blackness. I'm talking about our faithness. What do we do? You know, the we that touts the mantra that in Christ all are made one. What do? Who in times of relative safely quote scriptures that say, in Christ there is no Jew nor Greek, no bond nor free, nor male nor female. If we could put it in modern language, I'm sure Paul would have said, no black nor white. What do? Who believe this? May I pause for just a moment? Because I want to make sure that my church family knows that although this is a predominantly black church, that our identity expands beyond just our blackness. And that's what I'm trying to ask the question of. What do? I am a black man in America. I am a black Christian. I am a black Seventh-day Adventist Christian. All of those things congeal to inform or to inform my identity. But more than any of those things is the blood of Jesus Christ which covers me. And that, once I have taken on his name, that more than any other thing, where I'm from, who my mama, who my daddy was, that when I say I have taken Jesus Christ to be my Lord and personal Savior, when I say that the old man has died and I have risen to rise and walk as a new creature, that first and foremost informs who I am, my worldview, and how I react to, respond to things that happen in my world around me. If I wanted to respond to social injustice simply as just a black man in America, that could be very different than how I respond to it as a Christian in America. If I wanted to respond to social injustice in the world around me simply as a Christian, there is a defining line, a dividing line, a distinguishing line that distinguishes me just from any other Christian, as opposed to being a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. What? No, yeah. For real, for real. See, there's something about this church that is peculiar and that is special and that is different. And if that is in fact true, then it merits a peculiar and different response than from what everybody else is doing. But still, what, Leslie? What do? Do we just sit on the sidelines and merely watch, shake our heads, comment, gossip, grumble, and sometimes pray? Do we go and just pass out more steps to Christ and great controversies? Do we simply just hold more revelation seminars and do more revivals, just hoping that somehow that will stem the tide of violence and all the mess that's going on around us? Is that what we do? Or do we take to the streets and demand change in public policy? Do we become activists to vet responsible moral candidates for public office? That almost sounds funny. Do we plan protests and marches and sit-ins and exercise civil disobedience in efforts to right the wrongs of social injustice? Sister King, the question remains, what do we do? Well, I'd hate to go through all of the time and the trouble that we've just gone through to ask the question without attempting to posit an answer from Scripture. If you take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Micah, chapter 6. The book of Micah and chapter 6. And I believe that Micah here begins to prescribe what is required of us. In Micah, the book of Micah, tiny book in the Old Testament, this Old Testament prophet seer has had a relationship with God. God is speaking to Micah, and through Micah, God has spoken to you and to me. And he says this in verse 8, Micah chapter 6 and verse 8, which says, "He has shown you, O man, what is what? Good, and what does the Lord require of you? But to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God." He has required of you to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So that's what the Lord requires of us. In essence, family, that's what we should do. We should do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. Make sense? How many of you say it makes sense? Makes sense? Let me see your hands. Amen. I would beg to differ. It makes no sense. Did you really read or think about what you just read? Read it again. God says, "I have required this of you, Simi, to do justly and to love mercy." Let's stop right there. Right out of the gate. I'm not going to have time to finish this morning. But right out of the gate, there is some cognitive dissonance that ought to scream out of the pages and agitate your minds, your analytical minds. Why? Because justice and mercy stand at polar opposite cognitive ends of the logical spectrum. Justice and mercy don't make sense together. Why? Because you and I grew up knowing that if you do the crime, you should do the... That's justice. Doing the crime, justice says you do the time. But what does mercy say? Mercy stands in direct opposite cognitive dissonance to that idea. Mercy says, "I know that you're guilty, but I'm going to let you go. I know that you ought to serve 10 years, but I'm going to let you out in 5. I know." Mercy and justice stand at opposite ends. But yet here is what God is saying. This is what I require of you. I require of you to do justly, but to love mercy. Inherent, watch this. I wrote this down so I wouldn't forget it. Where'd it go? Implicit, here it is. Implicit in the requirement to love mercy is the expectation that the people of faith will by nature do what they love. Notice what I'm talking about. He did not say to do mercy or to be merciful. He said, love mercy. He said, do justly, but love mercy. Do justly. And so some of us might look at the text and say, well, he does not expect us to be merciful because all he asked us to do was to love mercy. But the implicit expectation is that a people of faith will ultimately do what they love. In other words, don't just tell me you love me. You got to show me, my baby said. Don't just tell me that you love mercy. Be merciful. You can't just come to church week after week, Sabbath after Sabbath, and say that we ought to be merciful, we ought to be kind, that we ought to be loving, that we ought to feed the homeless, that we ought to take care of the widows. And don't just say it. The implicit exhortation is, do it. If you love it, do it. Because if you ain't doing it, chances are you don't really love it. We can't truly love mercy and see the hungry, the homeless, the broken, the fatherless, the widow, the oppressed, the jobless, the depressed, the diseased, the devastated, the sick, the mentally ill, the mourning, the hurting, the abused, or whoever else. We cannot say that we legitimately love mercy while we pass by those who are in conditions worse off than ourselves and do nothing about it. And so God says your requirement is to love mercy. Isn't it interesting of why or where the do justly and the loving mercy comes from? Or the dichotomy between the two? So justice is required. Let me go back. So mercy is required when you love mercy, when it comes from a place of genuine deep down conviction, so that your cognitive thoughts become the actions of both your feet and your hands. But justice, not so. Watch me now. Justice, just do it. Whether you agree with it or not, whether you are sold on justice or not, whether you love justice or not, do justly. Figure it out later, but treat people right. You may think that they're worse than you. You may think that you're better than them. You may be genuinely, sincerely convinced that somebody else, because of their educational background, because of their pedigree, because of the color of their skin, because they've been here a shorter time than you, because they don't understand the language as good as you, that something may resonate in your mind that somehow you ought to have an advantage. The Bible says, okay, if you want to think that, fine, but do justly anyway. Justice, treat them just as you want to be treated. That's what justice means. Treating others just as we want to be treated. Whether it makes sense. Now, okay, we're good. I'm going to cut this just a little bit short. But I need to hang out at my next point here for just a minute. When you love mercy for mercy's sake, first of all, that's not why we love mercy. Nobody comes to love mercy just because mercy is merciful. We end up loving mercy. We love things most that we have had personal encounters with. You see a picture of a young lady, fellas, and you can say all you want that you love her. She can look good and look good in all the right places. sometimes, as much as you loved that picture, as you loved that image that was just in your head of her, after that first night out, many have come home thinking a whole nother story. Yeah, they might still love the picture that they had, but the woman herself is a whole nother story. Some of you married people like that. You loved the image and the dream of what it was going to be like. But now, 15, 25 years later, it's a whole nother ball game. But the reality is that we love things. We know that we love things that we have encountered. And so when it comes to mercy, you don't get to love mercy just for mercy's sake. People who love mercy are people who love mercy are people who have experienced mercy. People who love mercy have been on the receiving end of a merciful act of a merciful God who, you know, you didn't deserve it. There was no merit. You couldn't buy it. You couldn't purchase it. There was nothing you could have done, but you got it anyway. And now, because you've experienced it, so I said all of that to say that the people, and catch me now, the people who genuinely love mercy when it comes to social injustice, this is gonna be hard, trust me. They love mercy for both the oppressed and for the oppressor. Love mercy. You've experienced mercy. When you truly love mercy, you love mercy for both the oppressed and for the oppressor. Because you side with him who hung on Calvary's tree with two hands outstretched, nail pierced in each one, blood flowing from nails in his feet, back open from a cat of nine tails who looked out and said to the oppressor, of the oppressor, Father! Forgive them, because they don't know what they're doing. The thing that sets the Christian apart from everybody else who is wrestling and grappling with this issue of social injustice today is this point, that we, because of him who have experienced mercy, must love mercy both for the oppressed and for the oppressor. But it's hard. But that's why it doesn't make sense. Do justice and love mercy How do we reconcile, Elder Davis, these two opposing ideas? Do justice, love mercy. The answer, Brother Blackett, Micah gives us in the next phrase. And to walk humbly with thy God. What shall we do? Do the thing that doesn't make sense. Do justice, love mercy, but walk humbly with your God. Humility. Humility is this. This afternoon, the Bible study time, I want to spend some more time speaking more in depth and more in detail with you on this topic. 5 o'clock, I believe it is. Because we need to talk about some real issues. Before I get into this last part, I want to be clear about the position of Scripture. The position of Scripture, particularly in this text, it is not an issue of just sitting by and watching on the sidelines. Do. That's an action verb. That you got to get up and do something. To do justly. Psalms. I want to read you this other text before I get into it. Psalms chapter 82. Did I read that one to you already? Psalms chapter 82. Because I don't want you to miss this point, and I don't want to be misunderstood. Psalms chapter 82, verses 1 through 4. The Bible says this, and God stands. Psalms 82, verses 1 through 4. God stands in the congregation of the mighty. Y'all heard that? God stands in the congregation of the mighty. You can interpret that many different ways. God stands in the halls of the Department of Justice. God stands in the halls of Congress, the Senate, and the House. God stands in next one. And he judgeth among the King James reads the gods. The Hebrew translation of that means rulers. God. Oh, y'all didn't catch that. When juries who have power and are mighty, when they are in sequestered rooms and they are deliberating, God standeth. God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. A lawyer got on television the other day and said, as she was trying to prosecute a case, that the FBI and the Department of Justice told her that they would never subpoena a police officer. Just wouldn't do it. Who had been implicated in some kind of a case, shooting or whatever. But God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. But he doesn't just stand there. The next phrase says, and he judges among the rulers. God weighs everything in the balances. How long will you judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked? But then, remember, do justly. God doesn't in Scripture just categorically describe injustice. He prescribes action. Defend the poor and the fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and the needy. Do justice to the afflicted and the needy. Justice sometimes means more than just having a prayer meeting. Doing justice means sometimes more than just handing out a Steps to Christ. Sometimes doing justice means you've got to go and let your voice. Oh, Pastor, seriously? Verse 4, deliver. That's a strong action verb, Elder Gray. Deliver the poor and the needy. We always talk about how God needs your hands, your lips, your feet to go and be His witnesses, to go and tell the world that He's coming again. God is also requiring what He has shown you, oh man, what is good, and what He requires of us to do justice. I mean, sometimes you got to get up and deliver the poor and the needy, and watch this, rid them out of the hand of the wicked. Your job. Pastor Paul didn't say that, didn't write that. All I did was read it just like you did. One more. Keep playing though, keep playing. Y'all got to see this. Job, go with me to the book of Job, chapter 29. Oh, y'all, I know I'm going to get a whole lot of flack on this. I'm going to do it anyhow because it's the veritable word of God. Y'all remember Job, right? Y'all remember Job? Job was the one who God said to Satan, have you considered my boy Job, that he is perfect? God, just wasn't Job saying Job was, but God to Lucifer saying that he is perfect and upright in all his ways. Job chapter 29, Job was talking about what it was like when he was a kid. You read through this passage, there's a couple things that you're going to see. You're going to see Job said, I was fresh. He says, my glory was fresh in me. Job was so smooth. Job was so smooth. You're going to read in the verse where he says, I was so smooth I washed my steps with butter. Watch this. Verse 2, oh, that I were as in months past, in the days when God preserved me, when His candle shined upon my head, and when by His light I walked through darkness, as I was in the days of my youth, when the secret of God was upon my tabernacle, and when the Almighty was yet with me, when my children were about me, when I washed my steps with butter, and the rock poured me out rivers of oil, or when I went out to the gate of the city, and when I prepared my seat in the street. Watch this. The young men saw me, and they hid themselves, and the aged men stood up when I came through the gate. The princes refrained from talking, and they laid their hands over their mouths. The nobles held their peace, and their tongue cleaved to the roof of their mouth. When the ear heard me, it blessed me, and when the eye saw me, it gave witness to me. Because why? Here we go. Because I delivered the poor that cried, and the fatherless, and him that had none to help him. Because the blessing of him that was ready to perish came upon me, and I caused the widow's heart to sing for joy. I put on righteousness, and it clothed me. My judgment was a robe and a diadem. I was eyes to the blind, and feet was I to the lame. I was the father to the poor, and the cause which I knew not, I searched it out. Uh-oh. Y'all ready? But were you ready? And I break the jaws of the wicked. And I pluck the spoil out of his teeth. Then I said, I shall die in my nest, and I shall multiply my days as the sand. Pastor, are you trying to say that we ought to go out and break somebody's jaw? And pluck spoils from their teeth? I'm just saying that's what Job did. The man that was perfect and upright in all his ways before the Lord. Don't miss what I'm saying. See, when I take that and I superimpose it on mercy, that'll make sense. See, mercy and justice will never make sense to people who have made a habit of consistently not walking humbly with their God. When you make up your mind that you're going to walk humbly with God, that means that you have made a conscious decision, a conscious, intentional, deliberate, daily, moment by moment decision that I will subjugate my will to His. It was the same God, the same Jesus stretched out on Calvary's cross, who prior to Him saying, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do," it was that same Jesus who stood out on a palpable nothingness, opened His mouth and said, "Let there be light." And simply by the breath of His mouth were the heavens formed. He spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. So while up there on Calvary's tree, He did not need a congressional vote. He did not need a constitutional, whatever you call that thing. He didn't need, all He needed to do was nails would have popped out of His hands. The tree itself would have bowed down and said, "I'm sorry." The nails would have started confessing. But it was that same Jesus who hours before had knelt alone in a garden called Gethsemane, bowed prostrate before His Father and said, "Not my will. Not my will, Father, but yours." What was He doing? He was teaching you and me how to walk humbly with your God. That even when you have the power for vengeance, when you have the power, watch this, even when you have the power to enact vengeance, which we have called justice, God says, "That's not your role. Your role, do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with me." In other words, as you lean on me, as you trust me, no matter how dark the road gets around you, no matter how many times you are oppressed, no matter how many times you are taken advantage of, stay with me. Walk with me. Just stay with me. Walk with me. Don't go running and trying to find some other shelter that you think might protect. Stay with me. Walk with me. Stay close. But not just stay close, stay humble. Vengeance is mine. That ought to make you shout. You know how many hours husbands or wives have spent calculating, planning, scheming vengeance? Employees have spent calling meetings and scheming vengeance. how much effort and energy has been put in to trying to manufacture vengeance, but you called it justice. And how many times after all of your plans and all of your schemes and all of your orchestrations, and it still came to naught, God said, don't worry about the vengeance. Vengeance is real, nah. Vengeance is real. There's a place for it, but it's with me, God said. And I'll take care of that. I stand in the congregation of the mighty, but I judge among the rulers. I'm the one who's going to find out the what's what with the what's what. I got that. Vengeance is mine, and he doesn't stop there. He goes on and says, I will repay. There is coming a day when that wicked man is going to get his, but it ain't coming from you. Listen, the vengeance and the justice that God has planned for the wickedness in this world, you can't touch that. That man lying down in the street the other day with his hands up said he got shot, said it felt like a mosquito bit him. All the stuff that you're trying to do, when it comes face, when they ultimately come face to face with God's justice and God's vengeance, all that mess that you tried to heap on their heads, mosquito bites. Listen, you want vengeance? Then love mercy. You want vengeance about that man, that woman, who just couldn't stand to be in your presence, so they left you? Love mercy so much that you work to save their soul in the kingdom of heaven, so that day after day, after day after day, throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity, they still gotta come and see your smiling face. Appeal. I got to finish this another time, but somebody today knows that in your heart of hearts, whether it's dealing with social injustice or justice, your heart has been pricked, you've been fired up, you're afraid, you're scared, you're angry, you're upset, you're heartbroken, you're discouraged, you're disappointed. But the reason that you don't see a way out of that is because at this point, you know that you have not been walking with God. You've been walking some other places on your own and by yourself. And so these emotions have taken charge over you. They've taken control. And every time you read a post on social media, that anger and that just, well, you're not walking. And you know that you're not walking with God. And you want to say, yeah, I need to walk with him. Because I know that if I walk with him, he's got me. He's got this thing. I don't have to try to figure it out. I don't have to try to, all I've got to do is just to walk with him. And watch this. If he leads me to a march, to a rally, to a sit-in, I'm okay. Because I'm with him. If he leads me to somebody's door to give them a steps to Christ, a great controversy, if he leads me to invite them to a revelation seminar, then it's okay because I'm with him. Walking humbly with God means that you're going to allow him to answer the question, what are we going to do now? What are we going to do? The answer comes both generally and specifically when we make up in our minds to walk humbly with our God. that's going to mean something specific and different for each and every one that is here. Every individual, God has customized this thing for you. But if that's your desire, if that's your desire, as we close, I'm going to ask that you would just stand with me. Now, we've been working on some things to make this more than just a sermon. We've been meeting and talking and planning to get together with our own community leaders, our law enforcement. We've had personal conversations with our police chief and some of the others that are involved here. And we're wanting to take this and do this so that we are actually doing something. But watch this. And I need you to get this. We can change every law that needs to be changed. We can indict every guilty individual that needs to be indicted and convict them too. But the question remains, if everything that is on our social agenda gets fixed, gets addressed to the exact spot where we want it, then what? Not just then what, but also so what? Hosea chapter 4, verse 1, God says, "For the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the earth, because there is no truth, nor justice, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land." You can fix everything in a marriage, in a home. You can fix every ameliorate, every divorce. You can fix every treaty with any foreign nations. But until you fix your personal relationship with God, God is saying, "I've got a controversy with you." And unless and until you fix that, you can fix everything else you want to. But when the curtain is called and when the roll is finally called, there's going to be some folk who march that will still bust hell wide open. There will be some folk who got upset and angry over social injustice who will still burn in hell's fire. Why? Because they did not get their heart right with God. It's almost unthinkable to see the people of God getting upset over stuff that we were promised would happen in the world, that we were told would happen before Jesus comes. It's not a surprise. It didn't come by mistake. You knew that it was coming, but to see you get all upset and riled up over that, but you're still a liar. You're still cheating on a husband or a wife. You're still breaking the Sabbath. You're not marching about that. Children in the church still being disobedient to parents. You ain't marching about that. In the end, God says there is a controversy between me and the inhabitants of the earth that must be handled. And he's not saying don't address those other things, but make sure that when it's all said and done, you have come face to face with the convicting fire of the Holy Ghost, and you have allowed him to purge you of that thing that stands between you and your God and eternity. There might be somebody here today who knows that you got something in your heart, something in your life that is standing in the way. Yeah, you're upset, you're angry over the things that you've seen, the things that you've heard. You're uncomforted by the direction in which you may see politics going, and it's bothering you. What ought to bother you more is where you stand this very moment in your relationship with Jesus Christ. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that other stuff shouldn't bother you, and it should. But what ought to bother you more, what fits you better to be able to address those, is how you fix and deal with your relationship with the Jesus who died on Calvary for your sins and for mine. There's somebody here today who just wants to raise your hand and say, "Pastor, I know that Jesus does not have my all. I've held some stuff back. haven't given him everything, and today I just want to walk down the aisle and I want to give him everything that I am, so that I make a commitment from this day forward to walk humbly with my God. Is there somebody like that here today? Just wants to say, I want to walk humbly. I want to walk so humbly that the man, the woman, the boy, the girl that I am today, I need that man to be dead. I need to kill that man, that boy, that woman, that girl. And I want to go down in the watery grave of baptism, symbolizing that the old person who I used to be is now dead. And I want to rise to walk as a new creature. New creature, given a new heart. Is there somebody like that here today that just wants to say, I want to go down in the watery grave of baptism? If that's your desire, as we just sing the words, a verse and a chorus of this song, all to Jesus I surrender. So we just sing one verse, one chorus. If you feel the power, the pull, the begging, the pleading, the promptings of the Holy Spirit on your heart, I'm going to ask that you get out of your seat and just come down this aisle today saying, God, I need to give you everything that I am. All to Jesus, I surrender. If that's your desire. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. I surrender. Let's ring it out. I surrender. If you feel the Holy Spirit telling you today is the day, come on. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. Come now. Because the Spirit of God is calling. He's beckoning. He's calling you now. Then move now. All to thee, my blessed Savior. Let's just do that chorus one more time. I surrender all. I surrender all. Father, on this Sabbath day, we've gathered in this place. We came here today, Lord, with questions, wondering what is our role? What do we do? What can we do that will make the biggest difference and have the greatest impact? And Father, many are still leaving with that question today. But Father, if there is one answer that helps to crystallize the response, then Father, we're taking it from the pages of Holy Writ, and we are asking you now in this moment to teach us both individually and corporately what it means to walk humbly with you. Lord, we get what justice means. We understand because we've experienced mercy. Sometimes it's difficult for us to figure out how those two things work together. But Father, we know that as we walk with you in humility, that you can teach us and you can show us. So whether it's fixing issues that exist in our homes, whether it's fixing issues that exist in our schools, whether it's fixing issues that exist in our workplaces or in our communities or in our governments or in our world, Father, teach this people, in this auditorium, in this church, teach us how to walk humbly, day by day, side by side with you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.